wilderness and we can't find what we need. We get a little restless from the searching, get a little worn down in between. Like a bull chasing the matador, he's a man left to his own schemes. Well, everybody needs someone beside them, shining like a lighthouse from the sea.
Brother, let me be your shelter, never leave you alone. I can be the one you call when you're low. Brother, let me be your fortress in the night when you're driving on. Be the one to light the way, bring you home. Down in the desert now, there's a cage locked around my heart. I found a way to drop the keys where my failures were. Now my hands can't reach that far. I ain't made for rivalry, I can never take the world alone. I know that in my weakness I am strong, and it's your love that brings me home. Brother, let me be your shelter, never leave you. Brother, let me be your fortress when the night winds are driving on. Be the one light the way, bring you home. Brother, let me be your shelter, never leave you all alone. I can be the one you call when you're low. Brother, let me be your fortress. Cold when you're feeling low. Brother, let me be your fortress when the night winds are driving on. Be the one light the way, bring you home. Brother, let me be your shelter, never leave you alone. I can be the one you call when you're low. Your fortress when the night winds are driving on. Be the one to light the way, bring you home.
Matthew 22:34-40. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in law, tested him with this question. Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, Love the Lord your God with all of your heart and all of your soul and all of your mind. This is the This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is just like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. May the Spirit of God help us understand and live the word of God.
Thank you, Matthew. It is good to be with you in worship. If I haven't met you yet, I'm Pastor Dan, and I woke up a little snarky today, so I apologize, or you're welcome, depending on how this turns out. I want to recap, though, before we get into the series on where we've been so far. We're talking about the measures or the outcomes that we hope that God develops in each of us as we hang on to the people of Grace Church. And so I need your help with this. I want you to read the words next to the letters nice and loud. Okay, ready? So we started week one. G stands for? Good. And that was the question was, how am I giving my life away? Week two was R, which is? That was like first service too. Remain in love with Jesus. But the question there is, what is God teaching me? And last week, Pastor Grace knocked it out of the park, and she talked about A, which is? How is Scripture currently shaping me? And I love the illustration of having an anchor, but it's only as good as the rope that you tied to it and hold on to. You can have an anchor, but it's no good if you're not tethered to it. Well, this week I wanted to have Randy Newman introduce today's topic. So, Ashley, if you will.
I can't let you fool yourself away. I can't let you throw yourself away. Don't you want to see the sun come up each morning? Don't you want to see the sun go down each day? Don't you want to see that little girl who loves you so? Her heart would break. You should go. I can't let you throw yourself away.
You're welcome. That'll be in your head the rest of the day. So, Toy Story 4, if you haven't seen it, not going to talk about the movie at all, but I love this line because, you know, this little character keeps trying to throw himself away, literally, and Woody's job is to keep him from doing that. In the song, I can't let you throw yourself away, or as we're putting it in our Growing in Grace series, C, connected relationships. Who is my small group? Who are the people that when life falls apart are already in a relationship with you to hold you, to keep you from throwing yourself away? Who do you get to speak into their life in that same way? Are you connected? So let's define terms. To be connected means to be connected, which it seems like a no-brainer, right? But because if you're ziplining and you put your carabiner on, you're either connected or you're not, and you're going to find out real quickly, right? Connected means to be connected, to be tethered to be linked arms with, right? Are you connected in relationships? And a couple weeks ago, I talked about this anchor or remain in love with God is like holding on to God with everything you got. Remaining in love with him. And we talk a lot at church about this relationship with God, this vertical relationship, if you will. But today, one of our deep values here is that we're also connected in relationships to those around us. Jesus was asked this question by the religious leaders who also like to play by the rules. Matthew 22, teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. And that word like it means just the same. You shall love your neighbor as you love yourself. All of the law and prophets hang on these two commandments. Now, this is a common thing for religious folk to do. They would come to their rabbis, their teacher, and say, could you make it a little easier for us? Could you put it in Twitter 140 or 280 characters for us? There's actually one story of a guy who came to his rabbi and said, I want to be able to know all of the rules and commandments. You've got to tell them to me in a phrase that I can remember while standing on one foot. So this is a common thing. They're coming to Jesus, the teacher, and saying, what's your take on how do you summarize everything that God wants us to know about life? And he says, love the Lord your God and love your neighbor as you love yourself. 613 commandments. Every single word of the prophets is summarized in that. I have found that most people live functionally half of this commandment. You either have a deep relationship with God and a terrible relationship with people, or we like to have good relationships with people and maybe we're not hanging on to the relationship with God. And yet he said they're both the same. Two sides of the same exact coin. We functionally live sometimes half of this great commandment if we're not connecting in love with one another. I'm surprised, if I'm honest, that the signups for the marriage retreat next week aren't even higher. Because one thing we don't know in this world is how do we connect and meet each other's relational needs, right? And there's probably some people you wish would come. So what you say is, I need to come. Will you come with me? Right? If this is a need in your life, this is an opportunity to learn how to connect with one another. Let me give you some reasons why I'm so passionate about the sermon today. I could write it or read it without notes, most of it. Because our world is fractured in a lot of different ways. We don't understand one another. And it's always been that way to some degree, but now we have more means to show our divide. Whether you're Republican or Democrat, we know how those lines cross. We do this with races. We do this with socioeconomic levels. We do this generationally. This week, Kevin came into our staff meeting and shared some stats that he learned about the different generations. I'm just going to read some of this to you. I know you don't have it in front of you, but that's okay. They asked the question, are you connected to God and the church? So for builders or the silent generation, 75 years on up, and I'm not asking anyone to raise your hand, 65% of them said they are connected deeply to God or the church. The next generation down, the boomers, 55 to 74, 50% of them said they're connected to God or the church. Next generation, Gen X, 40 to 54, 33% of us are connected to God and the church. Millennials, 23 to 39, and these are broad strokes. I know you don't always fit in, I get it. But from a broad stroke level, millennials, 10% are connected to God and the church. And the generation under them, Generation Z, age 7 to 22, 5%. 65, 50, 33, 10, 5. If that's true, can you imagine trying to communicate about values and morals when they have different starting places? I'm not trying to judge either one as better than the other. They're different, right? They're different. And I'll share some stories later, but here's what I think is powerful, is I think God has something to say about how disconnected and fragmented our world is, and the church gets to embody this. I see it when we have music. Music has a way of connecting generations. I also think our stories have powerful ways to connect people that would otherwise be divided. Today, this afternoon, Pastor Earl from Vision Ministries and I are going to share about, there's a video that the conference is going to show about the history of racism, and then we're going to have a conversation. We're very different from one another, but through our stories, we've learned how to connect with each other. You all are invited 4 o'clock over in the sanctuary, and then we'll have conversation and some snackies afterward. But I believe so much that stories can connect us, I'm going to experiment with something. And so I need 2 volunteers. Great. Ava, perfect. Thank you for raising your hand. And Mark Smith. Where are you at, Mark? You can yell at me later. All right, come on. The good news is you don't have to listen to the rest of the sermon. So you're welcome. Okay, do you guys know each other at all?
Yeah, actually we do.
You have met?
Yeah, we've met.
Okay, all right. Well, it won't be as good, but this is fine. All right, I want you
to. Really know her.
You don't know her. Okay, I want you two to leave. You're younger than Mark, so you're probably in different generations in that gap. I want you guys to go sit out in the lobby, and I want you to share with each other your answer to this. An experience in your life where you knew that God was close to you. Okay, share that with each other. When you're done sharing it with each other, just come on back and find a seat. And at the end of the sermon, I'll bring you back up and ask you about your experience. Okay? You cannot keep going. You must come back. Otherwise, this will all fall on its face, and I'll blame you, Mark. Okay. All right, so while they go do that, here's where this comes from in Scripture. Remember, we are anchored in Scripture. So how we see the world in faith should come from how we see Scripture. At the very beginning, what's the first conflict in Scripture? It's not when Cain killed Abel. It's in Genesis 2. God had created humanity. And at the end of it, verse 18, he says, "It is not good that man is alone. It is not good for the man to be alone." And so I was thinking about this. What does he mean it wasn't good? What could possibly be not good about being created into the Garden of Eden? Right? Because here's the truth. He lived in a perfect world. There was no bloodshed. There was no warfare. There was no division. He lived in a perfect world. Secondly, Adam possessed everything he could possibly need or want. God said, "Look around you. You can take from everything but that one tree in the middle of the garden. You've got everything you need." Third, Adam had an exalted position. He was the steward over all of it. So he had a job. I mean, there's something about our humanity that longs for significance, right? He had it. He had a position. He had a job to do. He had all he needed. He lived in a perfect world. And lastly, he had an intimate relationship with God. There's an old hymn that says, "He walked with me, he talked with me along life's narrow way." I always want to say merry way, but I think I'm linking in a show tune, right? So if he had a perfect relationship with God, and the world around him is everything any of us could ever want, how is it that God said it's not good that he's alone? Because if we're anchored in Scripture, then Scripture tells us that God is not all we need. Now, before you run me off, let me explain. Because you need water and food, right? And God, through his grace, has provided means around us to take care of those legitimate human needs. In the same way, I mean, yeah, it all comes through God's hand, but he wired us from the very beginning that it's not good if we are alone. He wired us for connection. And just like we need food and water, he's saying, "Adam, it's not good if you're trying to live this life all by yourself. You are wired to need other people." So people of the church, get over it, right? This is how we're created, that we are meant to connect with one another. We're meant to be in relationship with another. Just as God is in relationship with his God self, so too are we meant to be meeting each other's relational needs as God sees fit. We need God and we need one another. We were meant for interpersonal connection as well. And here's where I just deeply believe our greatest transformation is going to happen together. I think we know this in different circles of our life. When a team is moving forward on the same direction and vision, if you go on a weekend experience, you will always remember the people you were with on that journey. And God fulfilled, he didn't just give them that commandment, "It's not good that you're alone." He said, "I will make a helper suitable for you." God knows the need we are created with, and he supplies. For Adam, it was Eve. For you and for me, it might be other folk in this room right now. Right? We need God. And humans are often the channels for which God communicates his provision. Our traditional worship leader told us a story at staff meeting this week. She's had the flu. She had to cancel choir, she said, for the first time in like 20 years. Because she was doing poorly. And as soon as she got over it, her husband got it. Last Monday, she was so tired of all of that. 5 o'clock, she gets out of bed because there's a knock at the door. She opens the door, and some of her good friends from a church showed up and said, "We thought you needed dinner." And she said, they can't imagine how important it was, how tender it was to our life, that they knew what we needed before we even asked and showed up with the meal. She said it happened 2 days after that as well. We know this. God uses other humans to communicate his love and grace to us. And sometimes that's our spouse, sometimes that's our kids, but we need one another. I read this great quote this week. Dave Ferguson said, "In his unsearchable wisdom, God opted to meet our relational needs through a love relationship with both himself and other human beings. By divine order, we are created with a capacity to love and be loved by God and others." End quote. We need God, and we need one another. So sometimes when people come to you with their issues, and we all got issues, right? Sometimes it is important to say you need a right relationship with God. But sometimes if they got a right relationship with God, that might just make them feel more shameful about their issues, when what they really may need is you to sit down and love them and to listen to their story. Because they may need forgiveness or reconciliation in a human relationship even more. That will come first sometimes before they know that God can forgive them too. It's amazing how we're wired for this, and we know it. Jesus, even at the end of his life, he was going off to the garden to pray. It was his darkest time of his life, and he gathered his friends, and he said, "Will you come and wait with me? Will you come and pray for me?" Can you imagine if one of them would have said to him, "No, you got your Father. You don't need me." But they didn't. They showed up with him. Now they fell asleep. Maybe they had too much wine at the Last Supper. I don't know. But Jesus, even at his last moment, wanted to be surrounded by other humans. This perfect one wanted to be surrounded by those closest to him. Now, our relationships are not meant to be what God is meant to be in our life. And no one human is meant to fulfill every relational need that we have in life. And that's some of the discernment. That's why some of these like marriage seminars are helpful, because how do you know when you're too close? Or when you've been hurt, how do you know when to weigh back in? We all need help in learning how to connect with each other. But transformation happens together, and there's some dangers if we don't get this message. The dangers of disconnection, number one, we get spiritually stuck. Because remember, it's not just about our love for God. It's also loving others as we love ourselves. Or 1 John chapter 4, verse 20 says this: "If someone says, 'I love God,' but does not love a fellow believer, that person is a liar." He didn't mince words, did he? He said, "For if we don't love people that we can see, how are we going to love a God that we can't see?" Or Howard Thurman, who I mentioned to you a couple weeks ago, he said this: "To be in unity with the Spirit," this is on your notes, "is to be in unity with one's fellows. Not to be in unity with one's fellows is thereby not to be in unity with the Spirit. The pragmatic test of one's unity with the Spirit is found in the unity with one's fellows." Isn't that convicting? Like, the measure of my relationship with God, he suggests, should be seen in my ability to be able to be connected and unified with you all. So the organization of the church, if you will, could have a common mission, a common dream, and we could agree on it. But if we're fractured in our relationships with each other, we're going to be spiritually stuck. The second danger is a wavering witness. We just had the members class, and I shared part of my story with them. I'm here today, I'm convinced, because of a group of guys who invited me into their life long before I ever believed that God loved me. Their witness of God's love, and really what they did, they embodied it. They let me see their marriage, they let me see how they parented, they were friends to one another. When I saw that, I'm like, I don't know what these guys believe, but I want some of it. Their witness, so the church's witness of how to love one another, was that which inspired me to want to love God. Or John chapter 13 says it like this: "By this we know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." So the fruit of our ability to love one another, our ability to love one another will bear fruit in how other people see God. That's scary, daunting, but God is good. God is faithful. He's always with us. And if we're not connecting, the third danger is lengthened loneliness. So I described the generational gaps, right? Of those who are connected to God and the church and those who are not. Well, these numbers go the opposite way. The builders, these are people who, the question was, are you lonely? Builders, 38%. Boomers, 42%. Gen Xers, 45%. Millennials, 45.5%. And Generation Z, 7 to 22-year-olds, 48.5%. So it goes from 38 to 48 in that same gap. So they're disconnected from God and the church, the youngest ones, and they're experiencing loneliness. Again, don't judge it, just name it. Okay, that's what they are self-proclaimed telling us. So what do we do with this? This all came full force to me a couple weeks ago when I watched the Grammys. And I saw this song sung, and it broke me. So the song was written and performed by Demi Lovato. She wrote this song 4 days before she overdosed, after 6 years of sobriety. When she said now, when she looks back at the song, she says, I listen back and I hear these lyrics as a cry for help. Ashley, why don't you play a portion of this song? Just listen for what's behind her words. You're going to take these lights.
I tried to talk to my piano. I tried to talk to my guitar. Talk to my imagination. Confided into alcohol. Tried and tried and tried some more. Told secrets till my voice was sore. Tired of empty conversation, 'cause no one hears me anymore. 100 million stories and 100 million songs. I feel stupid when I sing. Nobody's listening to me. Nobody's listening. But they always get it wrong. I feel stupid when I pray. So why am I praying anyway? If nobody's listening, anyone, please send me anyone. Lord, is there anyone? I need someone. Oh, anyone.
Tired of empty conversation, no one hears me anymore. I feel stupid when I pray. Why am I praying anyway? Nobody's listening. Anyone, please send me anyone. Lord, is there anyone? This is the cry of our world right now, and I think the church is in the perfect position to not judge, but to come alongside, because here's what God did for us, right? When we felt most outcast, when we were broken by our own mistakes, when we were covered in our shame from our sin, God didn't stand far off. He came close. He sent his very love, his son, to embody our flesh, to embody our loneliness, and say, I'm going to redeem all of humanity through my blood so you can be healed, so you can be well. So our ability to connect with one another in relationships has the potential to change the tides of all of our culture. When we want to retreat, instead I'm encouraging you to press in. And I think your heart is that. Like, so why wouldn't we do it? And so here's some just general observations that I've noticed of why we often don't connect in relationships. And number one is fear. We've been hurt. Or we're scared that church folk are messed up. Well, let me tell you, if you don't know, we are. Imagine if we didn't know Jesus. right? And we want to know, are we going to be loved or are we going to be judged if we show up and share what's really going on in our life? And I get it. The second thing, reason why I think we don't connect is self-reliance. We tell ourselves, I don't need it. I got me and Jesus. I don't need anything else. And yet I've come to find, I had that stance for one point. But when you come to know real Christian love, you'll never go back. You'll wade in to the hurt. Because we're humans. We're going to make mistakes. We're going to hurt one another. But when you have a real experience of a place where you belong and you can come closer to God and one another, it's worth diving in past the fear. The third reason I think we don't connect is we want to be in control. And relationships are messy. They're messy. It's easier to have judgments of people unknown than to connect beyond one's control. The danger, at Robert Mulholland said, is this. Corporate spirituality is essential because privatization always fashions a spirituality that in some way allows us to maintain control of God. In other words, when I'm not connected with my brothers and sisters, I start to think unintentionally that God thinks just like I think. God loves just like I love. But when you start having relationships with other messy, broken people, you start to have to ask yourself questions. What does it mean to love someone I'm not like? What does it mean to love someone who drives me absolutely nuts? Right? But there is a power in connection. There's a deep power in connection. In Acts chapter 2, I mentioned this 2 weeks ago, when the church was all united in purpose, they shared what they had with one another. It said daily, the Lord was adding to their number. Because they're, I think all of us want to be a part of a community that embodies the love that is going to liberate us and help us live the life that God wants us to live. We want to be a part of that, and the church is set up for that. Second example I see of this is marriage. We used a song earlier that said God is going to come get his bride, and he wants her to be clean. So it's a metaphor. God loves the church like a bridegroom loves a bride. Our marriages are meant to reflect this incredible connection. And I don't know about you, but I know several marriages that when I just watched this couple love each other, it told me a whole lot about who God was. Right? We know the power of connection. When you can see this embodied, you're like, yeah, I want that. You and I might be the answer to Demi Lovato in her prayers. So let's try this. Walt, if you'll bring that light, those lights back up. Mark, Ava, come on up. I had other names written down, Mark. I may have some gifts. Wisdom might not be one of them. Is that what you're saying? Okay, Ava Bachbrader, Mark Smith, come on right up here if you will. Okay, you don't have to share the story that you shared with each other. But I am curious, is there something that you learned about the other that you're thankful you learned? Or is there any connection between your stories that just happened to emerge?
She's sweet. I've met her before just one time at a friend's graduation party. And I knew she was from Grace. And you two have done a phenomenal job.
Is there anything you learned about her from what she told you in her story?
She's a sophomore at Notre Dame, and says it's kind of hard, and she's got her driver's license, and she's studying science, and she likes people. She likes God.
Amen. So, Ava, anything you learned about Mark?
I learned that... A moment where he really saw God was when he met his wife. So,
If that's what it was, if this was a setup, I was going to come here and say, obviously, my mountaintop experience was meeting Janice.
He's a smart man, but yeah. So, what about his story of meeting his wife? What did that speak to you? I'm totally putting you on the spot.
That really wasn't the story.
I mean, most of the time we just really talked about how, like, in life you go through times of, like, ups and downs, and how, like, in like the times of downs, like you just have to really keep your head up, and like even though there's times that like you don't want to come to church, or like you it seems like you won't see the end, or like things don't seem like they'll get better, you still have to just keep pushing through and keep praying, even though sometimes it seems like God isn't on the other end. Like, you still have to come to church, and you have to keep reaching out to others to pray for you, because like there's like maybe one time that you'll come to church and the message will speak directly to your heart, because like that's God speaking to you like all the time, because like God is still there and like he has a plan for you.
Amen. Amen. We thank them for their willingness, bravery, and I'm sorry. Mark said he didn't want to come to church today. It's funny, we prayed before first service today for the one who didn't want to come to church. Seriously, we seriously prayed for the guy who didn't want to come to church today, that the Spirit of God would awaken him to his need to be here. So if that was you, Mark, we prayed you here. Friends, I deeply believe our stories have the potential to change lives. If you're in that 55 on up category, don't raise your hand. If you're in the 35 and under category, you know who you are. You need one another more than you know you do. Because the stories that you each are walking through need the prayers and support and wisdom of the other. It's the one thing that no one can take away from you, and it's the one thing that provides healing in this crazy life that we're called to live. Here's what I want us to do to end. I'm not going to show that second video, if you will, Ashley. I want us to do something. So you have choose your own adventure. Some of it's on the screen. Some of it is in your notes. But we're all going to do A together, and then you can choose B, C, or D. Okay, so A is this. You have permission to pull out your phones, if you got one. And I want you to think of somebody that's not in the room right now that is really important to where you are right now in your relationship with God. Someone that's a dear friend that you would say, man, I'm so thankful for them. And I want you to send them a text. If you don't have a phone, you can write them a note later. You can steal these words. Thank you for your friendship. God is using you in powerful ways in my life. Just send them a note. While I was sitting here, I got a note from someone from First Service. You can go ahead and do that right now. Is there somebody that you're so thankful they're in your life that you just haven't told them in a while? Because you know this to be true. God uses our human words to bless others. Last week, someone came forward for prayer at the very end. And I know we've been inviting you to do that. We'll invite you again to come forward for prayer at the end. One of the prayer people, in praying for this one, spoke words over them that the prayer person couldn't have known if God didn't tell them. And when it was heard and received, the person who came forward for prayer was like, God sees me. Human words spoken because God asked them to, and it blessed the socks off of this person. Your text, your notes of encouragement might just be something that pulls them out of even their loneliness. All right, B, C, or D. You can choose one of these that you do. Pray every day at lunch this week for God to put you into a life group. Now, I'm not trying to control this. I have a deep belief that we need to be in relationship with each other, whether it's Bible study, small group, but with people where you can actually be human with. If you're not in one now, would you pray every day that God would put you in one? Or maybe you're the answer to the prayer. Maybe God's asking you to start what you want. Maybe you're called to live life with people. Would you pray every day at lunch? That's option B. C, if you are in a small group already of some sort, you know, the printing press is a modern phenomenon. What would it be like if you only read scripture in community? Like if you didn't pull out your phone and you had to go to community in order to hear and read scripture. Maybe you want to choose that just to realize that you need God and one another. Or option D, share your story and listen to somebody else's story. Sit down with them. Share your story. You can use the same prompt I gave Mark and Ava. Is there a time in your life when you knew God was close to you? Share that with each other. See what happens. Find someone you don't know real well and trust God with the results, because transformation happens together. And here's my heart, and I think you know this, and I think it's yours too. I can't let you. I can't let you. I can't let you throw yourself away. Let's pray. God, we need one another. It's your love that is our anchor, our strength, our supply. And oftentimes you reveal your love through other human beings. And it's messy and it's difficult. And yet without it, we're missing out. So God, however we need to meet the relational need that we all have, to do it in a healthy way, to do it in the context of relationships that are going to spur us on to Jesus. God, may your love bind us together. May your love hold us together. May your love connect us one with another. Is there anyone? Anyone? Lord, is there anyone? God, may we be the answer to that prayer. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.